Thank you very much, Zvi, for inviting me to come here. It's always a great joy to be in this country. So, what you see here on the first picture is a telescope, and it nicely connects to the other speakers, because we use this kind of telescope for quantum communication on the Canary Islands. And we are on the Canary Islands not for the reasons you think we are there. You know, it's not for the wine or the food, but on the Canary Islands you have what is called the European Northern Observatory. These are clusters of telescopes built by various European countries and collaborations for the observation of the sun and of the night sky, as the logo indicates to the upper left of this picture here. The title I chose was Quantum Information from Burlesque Ideas to a New Information Technology. And before I go into more details, I want to mention two things. Firstly, quantum physics was developed in the beginning of the 20th century, initially to explain behavior of individual particles, of atoms and so on, and it turned out to be one of the most important ingredients in modern technology. If you look at your mobile phone, it contains a computer which contains semiconductors which you cannot understand without quantum mechanics. The laser cannot be understood without quantum mechanics and so on. So why do I talk here about the new information technology? The point is that the old information technology, if I might call it that way, is based on the behavior of many particles, like many photons, many particles of light, many electrons and so on. This statistics is very well understood. What we have now is we have now new ideas where we base our concepts on the behavior of individual particles. This is something which was considered to be completely impractical even until the 1960s, but due to technological progress we can do these kind of things now. And the field was started because people wanted to see whether the predictions of quantum physics for individual particles are really as strange or as burlesque as the forefathers told us, including Einstein. And then, to the surprise of everybody, a new field of information technology arose. Here is one of these Gedanken experiments invented by Erwin Schrödinger in the same year as the paper mentioned by our chairman, by Einstein, Podolsky and Rosen was published. It's the famous Schrödinger cat, which brings home some of the fundamental issues and questions. Just to explain it very briefly, you have a cat which is enclosed in a container together with some glass vessel which carries cyanic acid. And the whole thing is devised, connected to a Höllenmaschine, to hell engine, as Schrödinger calls it. It's a radioactive atom, and if the radioactive atom decays, a hammer is released and breaks the container. So, this is all not very kind to the cat, but now let's talk about quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics tells us that after some time, we cannot say that the atom is decayed or not decayed. Actually, the quantum state of the atom is a superposition of decayed and not decayed. It's both at the same time in some sense. Now, Schrödinger says, if quantum mechanics is universally valid, the cat should also be in a superposition of dead and alive at some time. So if, since we do not see superpositions of dead and alive cats, there is a problem here. There is a fundamental problem, there's a conceptual problem, something might be wrong. You might say this is just a strange way our physicists talk about things, but it turns out that this idea to investigate quantum phenomena for objects of increasingly larger size is one of the most vigorous research programs worldwide right now. More and more groups are entering this, and there are actually ideas which make it not completely unreasonable to think about superpositions of living systems someday. It's, to my opinion, it is more or less just a question of clever ideas, young good students, and enough money. Here is the notion of entanglement introduced by Einstein in the paper mentioned. It is, if we would have quantum dice, just consider a pair of dice, if they would behave according to the laws of quantum mechanics, then when you throw the two dice, they always show the same number. And it is completely unpredictable which number they show. And it turns out that if you throw them at large distances, no matter how far apart, they will still show the same number. So there can be two possible explanations. One is that there is some secret mechanism in there which makes them behave the same way. Or secondly, there is maybe some communication between them which also makes them to show the same results. We can exclude both explanations. So we have two random processes which always give the same result no matter how far they are away. This was called by Erwin Schrödinger the basic mystery of quantum mechanics. Why do we say that the individual dice are completely random? This is one of the basic findings of quantum physics. To me, it's one of the deepest findings of science in the 20th century, that there are processes which are so random that there is no cause. There's no way to give a causal explanation why the process happens that way. This is, for example, for the case of the dye. It is specifically in the laboratory. We have this for the decay of radioactive atoms. We cannot say at which time an atom decays. And not only we cannot say it, I try to challenge my theologically inclined friends, saying them that not even God knows when the atom will decay. Some don't like this, but that's a separate question. So we have objective randomness. Einstein didn't like that. He said he's convinced that God does not play dice with the universe, to which supposedly Bohr gave him the answer, stop telling the Lord how to run the world. Now, we have these two notions of entanglement and randomness, and one of the explanations is quantum teleportation, already mentioned here. It's the basic drawing of a recent experiment which we just finished a few weeks ago between the two Canary Islands mentioned. I don't want to go into the technical details, people can look it up on the web. The basic point is that you can teleport the quantum state of a photon over a distance, in that case 140 kilometers. Now, I have to disappoint you, this is not a future way of transportation, but it is a future way of communication between future quantum computers. It's the best way how future quantum computers will talk to each other. Actually, do you know why they invented in these Star Trek movies teleportation? It's basically to save money. To make the, you know, if you would have to film the landing of a planet and the start from a planet, it costs a lot, because every planet looks differently. So, but if you beam the guys up and down, it's much cheaper. And they knew that there are problems with it. Their basic idea was that you scan the information of a system and send the information to the receiving station and reconstitute the object. Now, according to quantum mechanics, this cannot be done, because Heisenberg says that you cannot determine the quantum state of a system completely. So to fix that, these guys invented, you Star Trek fans know this, invented the Heisenberg compensator. And at one press conference, one of the guys was asked, how does the Heisenberg compensator work? And his answer was, very well, thank you. Now, what we have learned in quantum mechanics is that you can transfer the information from A to B without A. This information taking any well-defined path, it just disappears here and shows up there. And secondly, you only can do it if you and nobody knows what this information is. That way we circumvent all these kind of limits. Now this kind of experiments proves that in the future we will be able to go to space. Now I mentioned quantum information. We talk about the field of quantum information processing and communication, which as Bill Phillips, Nobel laureate in 1997, says, is more fundamentally different from current technology than the digital computers from the Abacus. Why does he say that? Because in the digital computer, as well in the Abacus, information is represented as real features of real objects. In the quantum computer, we don't have that anymore. We have superposition, we have entanglement, the information is non-local, and so on and so on. What the field promises is computers of unprecedented speed, because they operate in a new complexity class, as we say. They can solve problems which are simply too complex for any conceivable classical computer, and they promise communication security, which is guaranteed by the laws of nature. They operate with individual particles, with individual photons, with individual atoms, and so on and so on. The future is in space. This connects to the talk right now. The idea is to establish worldwide quantum communication using, for example, the International Space Station or other satellites. We have a program collaborating with the Chinese Academy of Sciences to put a quantum satellite into space within the next 5 years. And it actually is amazing, and this is something where one can learn something from. It's actually amazing how fast China is able to make decisions. It's impressive. Europe is far away from that. So, just to mention one possible new application of quantum information, it's called blind quantum computing. It's a very recent concept. The question is the following. You all know what cloud computing is. You have a central server, and you use the central server to solve some problems. Now, in the end, you want to make sure as a client that the central server has no idea whatsoever what you are doing there. Not only the data, but also the kind of program you are using should be completely hidden to the central server. And it is only that quantum computing can solve this kind of problem. I don't want to go into the details now, but this to me is probably one of the most important ideas in the field, which I feel, I'm actually convinced that someday we will have quantum computers and all this, because there's no basic obstacle against this kind of thing. But it may be that the most important consequence are conceptual consequences. More and more points to the view that information is basically, in a sense, the most fundamental concept in the universe. It's not matter, it's not reality, it's information. And it's something like the irreducible kernel from which everything else flows. This is an open program which has not been finished yet, but in the end it might mean that we humans as observers play a more important role than we usually see it. If you want to read, for example, this article, you can look it up on my website. I want to end with the basic point that whatever happens is unpredictable. We have learned many times in basic science or in research that the really fundamental issues have not been seen even by the inventors. There's a famous quote. Michael Faraday was once asked by Sir Gladstone. He was they called him Chancellor of the Exchequer, the finance minister of Her Majesty. He asked Faraday, this is all very nice, but what is it good for? And Faraday said, one day, sir, you may tax it. That's the best answer you can give a finance minister. What exactly will be done, Faraday didn't know, but he had a feeling that this is very important. Likewise, the guy who invented radio waves, Heinrich Hertz, he asked for money to the Prussian Academy of Sciences, and he got the money even as, and this is now a literal quote from the referee reports, even as this will never lead to a practical application. So the basic point is the really big breakthroughs are found in ways and by people who themselves don't even have an idea what happens. So I'm sure we will have quantum computation someday. I'm also sure that this will revolutionize, but what, I don't know. Thank you very much.